economic plan, one of the goals is to create more visitors and also a caravan stroke motorhome. So there's lots of issues. I've touched on some of them, rightly or wrongly, and I do think today, needs to say, that we need to look at it in more detail and come back to this committee with more information on it and set up a working party chair.
Thanks, Pat. Julie.
Thank you, Chair. I do sympathise with Mrs Foster, and irrespective of whether or not we think it's pretty that the caravans are there or whether we have concrete blocks there, I think what Mrs Foster has alluded to is that she's a council tax and rent payer, as is my auntie living in Mockbeggar, so I do sympathise. Over the years, four years, as long as I can remember, they've very often in the summertime been tents in the dips. And by and large, people take away their rubbish from at the end of the day. But I have to say that the numbers of caravans are increasing. And I agree with David. I mean, initially I thought we set up a working party, but I think that before that we should look at exploring and talking to the councils in your area, the area that you come from, as to whether we can put an overnight ban on not allowing sleeping in vehicles. And that might just solve the problem. Let's try and keep it simple.
Thank you. Jerry.
Thanks for bringing your mic.
Sorry, Jerry.
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, Jerry.
Yeah, that's fine. There's a couple of points I'd like to raise, and it's something that I know Christine, my colleague, has mentioned on numerous occasions, and many other people in the Labour Council, Walter Smith, too. We ran down that camping site at their system, I think it was because of antisocial behaviour at some time. But what a major mistake we made by, here we are, we're talking about the visitor economy and the importance of visitors to the area. Now there is a site that is absolutely ideal for tourists to use. So why aren't we as a council doing something about that? And whether this would have a rub off on the situation in New Brighton, it probably would, I don't know. But I do think that we really need to look at having a proper visitor site. We're now, as you say, it's now 2018, as everyone has said, we've got one of the biggest tourism economies, a thriving tourism economy. Surely we've got to do something about that. Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. Just two quick points. I think you're right, there are two caravans. First one that comes out, caravans. You're right, the council's facility there, which is currently used to a great deal. We have recently done a very modest amount of work on the community block there to allow it to be used by some groups, but you're right, there is potential to develop that. I guess the argument comes back to get people to stay where they want to be. Just on the unorganised stays and sleeping, I might be wrong, but my Cumbrian background, I do know that in the National Park legislation, there is legislation through bylaws to prevent people sleeping in vehicles overnight. So I know if you go to a car park in the national park, you can leave your camper van overnight in the car park, which you cannot sleep in. So I think it's a really good idea. We'll just check out if it extends to the national park.
Steve.
Thanks, Chair. It might be to the detriment of the camper owners. I don't know if they realise it. The problem is they want to turn out the road and they've got a motor vehicle. I'm sure quite a few of them have a drink. If they go over the legal driving limit, the fact that they're not driving is still committing an offence. So that's something else as a council we should be looking into as well.
Thanks, Mike. A couple of points. One to be hypothetical and one based on what Councillor Hackett said. He mentioned travellers. So let's assume that travellers turn up one night and park 30 vans at this point. Do we as a council remove them? would we accept they have a right to park there as any other person? What would the council's reaction be to that? If it was travellers parked there, would we move them on? Or would we leave them there, just like we're leaving these other 37 campervans? I'm sure we would move them on. There's no officer jumped to say, well, we have to look at that, but I'm sure they would be moved on. Because if you've seen the travellers, and yet they're doing nothing different to what these people are doing. These people may not be travellers, but they're acting like travellers. Second point I want to make, and I'm going to go back now maybe, and I'm here, perhaps Anita will be able to help me. Lisa Common was really well used. Yeah. Caravans, people trying out all things, tents, this and the other. Back in the Aristotle days, we opposed it, but the council banned people using vehicles on Lisa Common. We're such a great visitor colony, why are we banning people from using Lisa Common? I can't understand how we can collate. It's okay in this area if you've got a visitor colony, but in more the other band, you can't operate the board. Because our visitor colony doesn't matter, you know. So let's get this right. And you know, as I say, this has been going on now for years. I hear what Dave has said about a working party. Well, let's not drag this on for another 12, 18 months going through all the rigmaroles. Let's do something simple. I'm always saying David's come up with an idea, a suggestion that might be worth some exploration. Let officers go away and explore it, come back to the next meeting with a report on that and see where we go forward from there.
I'll bring you back in then. I think that's a very interesting point that Chris has just made, that if they were travellers, we'd be down there like a shop with the police and everything else.
Families who come to Lisa Common, they parked in the car park. We move them. We move them.
They parked on the car park because they ran out of space on the grass.
Hang on, please. Anything that's said comes through the chair.
Sorry,
can I respond to...
In a minute, Denise, I've got other people. You can respond. I would like the... David, you intimated, you know, but that's a fair comment that Chris made about the designation, the definition of travellers and non-travelling. The caravans, the motorhome owners, by definition, are travellers. But David,
I just think one difference is that the travellers, when they come off and take off, they tend to go on land, or private land. They tend not to build themselves up. All these vehicles are actually lined up on the public highway. I think what I saw on Sunday, which was the vehicles parked all over the grass mile, I think if that became a regular feature and people were leaving there for some weeks, I think the council would have to take a second form action, because that simply isn't acceptable. And that's a green space for it. It's meant for the pleasure, the quiet pleasure of everybody. It isn't meant to become a parking area. So there is one. The difference is to do that and they don't have the highway. I think the council personally will need to take the same actions it does with anybody who comes to parks being residential vehicles on its line.
Thank you, David.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Just a very brief comment. I understand his concern about the £20 charging for overnight not being right for campervan. I would totally agree with that. The people who complained that were the ones, do you, Chair, were in West Kirby and Hoylake who were forced, because of the parking restrictions that already exist on lack of parking provision in the side roads from Banks Road and from Market Street down to the promenade. The residents there are forced to park on the promenade overnight because there's nowhere else for them to park. Now, it would have been totally unreasonable, which was part of one of our arguments, for individuals to be charged £20 a night or £140 a week to park their car outside on the promenade 50 yards from their home because it was impossible to park at that. That's what the petition was about, but it wasn't about campervan situation. So those two items need to be separated totally from each other. Okay, Chair, thank you.
Thank you, David. Did you indicate, I'll bring you in, Leslie. Did you indicate you wanted to speak, Dave?
Yeah, Leslie will first.
I think Leslie intimated she wanted to.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chair. I've listened to all the arguments for and against, and I'll still move that we should look towards a working party, because the first thing is we bring an overnight ban in that particular area, they'll just transfer themselves somewhere else and come last night's money. We need to look at the whole issue in relation to everything. We've heard so many different things in so many different ways that we need to tackle this particular problem. And it's easy to say, we're looking at New Brighton, but who's to say it's not going to move to Bromley, East and West Kirby, Mells, places. So as an authority, we need to have a plan that will be accepted everywhere, not just in the city.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Ned.
Hi.
Gillian.
It's just further to what Dave was saying. I don't know how much intelligence, or to better words, has been gathered by the authority as to who the people are that are using the caravans and so in those homes. So have we got any information looking at the demographic? Have we got anything that suggests trends, whether it's a wealth trend that people are, you know, more economically viable, that they're moving around from children to visit places, or is there a proportion of people who are struggling who might actually be having to live in a family home or a mobile home? I'm just wondering about just other depths of information, whether we have that.
Yeah, we've not done a scientific study following my meeting with Mrs. Foster. But interestingly, it's just to go back to the point, when I've had a drive around in the mornings, currently we find about 4 to 5 vehicles maximum on the front of West Kirby, and around the same number, 4 to 5 vehicles a quarter. So the I don't do this all day, but the odd times I have been around all three on the way in. Those are the figures. It is not on the same scale as what they in West, but again, it is happening. In terms of the people, in terms of the vehicles of West Kirby, Brighton, I thought we had three categories. I think there are one or two there that are parked up, which people use from time to time, and they may not live too far away, or they may come and go, and some of the vehicles don't move, but there don't appear to be any activity around them. There's one in particular that I can think of. The bulk of them come and stay, and then people are live to in the countryside. There's at least one, possibly two, where the people living there would claim they are living there out of necessity. Not on the front, but in the road behind. There are two there, and this is possible to do. I mean, there's a caravan rather than a caravan end, where the person living there has corresponded with the council to say they are living there out of necessity. So I think there's one or two cases of that, one or two vehicles that I think are kept there out of convenience. Whether people come and use them, I don't know, whether they will locally, I don't know where to put them. But the bulk of people who come and go and stay one or two nights and come and go.
Have we got any powers then to actually do a survey, to actually take that intelligence and to use that? Because if there is a trend of people out of necessity living that way, then that's a worrying trend.
I don't think it's a trend. I certainly know of one, just being careful here about, you know, data protection and things. I do certainly know of one case. But that case has been there for some time. I don't think that is a significantly developing issue. But it would be wrong to say that there's at least one or two people there who feel they are living there out of necessity. But the bulk of them are vehicles that come and go. And the bulk of them are relatively new vehicles, so relatively. And then, as I say, there's one or two that seem to be parked there all the time, whether they're just being stored there. They're taxed and insured, so people can do that if they wish.
Thanks, Chair. I was just wondering, just moving through, there's a lot of useful comments here that can be explored in much more detail than the working policy. And I think that's probably the best place to work out a policy, if we can do this, because otherwise we'll be sitting in trouble all night and never made any progress. But I think it's great. It's just a suggestion.
Did you want to mention anything?
Thanks, Chair. Just to answer Councillor Lynch's questions, the least silent common was used by a lot of people when they were walking forward for a day trip or a stay overnight in the tent, and it was very welcomed. However, people decided that they would start staying for raves, which was not exactly what you'd expect in a residential area, so that's why the council had to spoil it for the many,
Save of the few. my point really I wanted to make is that I agree with David Dalton's suggestion regarding the overnight sleeping, and rather than wait until the next committee to bring that back, I would suggest that if the officers feel that's something that we can do, that we should do it as soon as possible. And what then, I also agree with David Mitchell in that we should have a working party on this, and other comments that have been made, that it's too broad and there's too many ifs, ands, buts and maybes to just say that this is going to resolve it, because I don't think it will. I really don't think it will. And as we've said, it could impact on other areas of the borough as well, and I just think we need to have a good look at it.
Yes. Thanks, Anita.
Thank you.
Can I just, before you speak, Leslie, if you will allow, thank you. Leslie's going to be the last speaker on this. I've given everybody the opportunity to speak. So Leslie's now going to make, I don't know, some suggestions or some more questions. But Leslie is the last member who's going to speak.
Leslie,
thank you.
Thank you, Chair. If I repeat some of the things that other members have said, then I apologise. But if I can just take up a few points, and then just really to add a little bit of, and it may be anecdotal evidence as well, just to put a little bit more meat, any more meat was needed on this particular bone. I was never suggesting that we put a ban on no overnight parking on the whole of the promenade, but the reason why we specifically would be interested in a total overnight ban in that particular area is just as you come up Harrison Drive, you know where they park on both sides of that road, and on the road which leads to the sailing club, is because both of those are dead end roads. The attraction why people want to park there is because it's nice and quiet, there's no passing traffic. I don't believe that if we put a ban on that specific area, it would necessarily displace it further up the promenade, because I don't want to see them parked up on the promenade, like I'm sure many of them do. I mean, it's all right for Councillor Hackett to say, they're not really a problem all the time, it's not too bad an issue. It's not in your ward, Matt, predominantly this. This is a problem that, Wallasey residents are no different than any other resident anywhere else in the borough, other than they are living there day to day and seeing this go on. I don't know, you said you had none of your residents have complained, but you haven't got these vans parking in such numbers on your Brown Promenade where residents have to live and observe as soon as they open their curtains in the morning. But it's not about the residents of Wallasey Wood in any way being NIMBY, because it's far broader than that. There are huge hygiene issues with this, as Mrs. Foster has alluded to. I personally have seen numerous bottles filled with urine in the litter bins down there, and I reported it to the chief executive of this council. He basically intimated that I should go down there and bring the evidence to him. I don't necessarily think that that's my role. I'll get involved in anything, but I think you have to draw the line at that, and perhaps hand that over to environmental protection officers. But as a few people have said, clearly there needs to be a site somewhere in Wirral. I understood that we've got about 90 spaces at the site at first, and I understand that may be a little bit of a driving distance if people want to come to New Brighton, but it's not beyond the realms of possibility that people couldn't park if the site was made to a better standard down in Thurston. There's 96, that's 90 spaces, there's 96 spaces for overnight camper vans at Fair Oaks, at by Cheshire Oaks, and then we've got a number of small farms where they're designated as a certificated area across Wirral where obviously people can go. The attraction of this is, and it may just be of interest to Councillor Wood, because the people that are coming here, yes, there is a mix, but predominantly these people are coming because there are at least six sites on the internet internationally where these sites are advertised as a place to come, a place to go, nobody bothers you overnight, and it's free. So, I mean, how we tackle that, that's a huge issue. but there's also more anecdotal evidence, you know, and I hope my hand is anecdotal. I haven't seen them. Residents have reported there are certain businesses running out of these. And yes, we have trade and standards down, particularly with a couple of bands that it was alleged that they were running an over tire business. That didn't actually come to anything at the moment. That doesn't mean to say we shouldn't look at that further. There's also been allegations that there are at least two females who run a business out of one of the vans. I'll leave that to your imagination what that might be. But clearly, whatever's going on down there, I think between 4 to 5 years has clearly, you know, I don't see why the residents have to push up with it any longer. So all the reasons, I mean, not all, but there's a couple perhaps still to be explored that perhaps Mark Smith that would be willing to look at, but nothing really that's been said here tonight hasn't been looked at before. So I don't see why we can't see how it goes and put on a total ban. Any vehicles just sleeping in their vehicles, staying overnight in those two small roads at the bottom. That's not going to clearly affect council Legion and night time activities. It's only that very gravitate up into New Brighton, because the popularity of it is growing, as we might see. The numbers I've witnessed, 37 vans, residents have said there's sometimes in excess of 40, and as I say, we've now got them parking on the green open spaces as well. They may well bring something to the economy of Wirral, and I'd be the first to say I want to attract people as much as the next person here, but that cannot be to the detriment of local residents day and night every single day of the year. So I think we should try an overnight ban, see how it goes, and I know there's a cost implication to this, but you know, at the end of the day, I think residents have to be considered fairly in this. So if people are parking down that far end, and I have to say many of these camper vans are so huge, they can't park on the straight part of the road next to the seawall. They park on the other side. They are having a small vehicle in a number of instances, you know, a small Fiat 500 attached to the back of these vehicles. So they are parking so long they can't get into the horizontal bays there. So they're parking across at least 2.5 to 3 disabled spaces down there. Something has to be done. You know, we can sit around, we can illuminate, we can talk about it, and as I say, you know, we're going to come back to the same problem. Well, what do we do? So if I think it's a great idea, we've talked about this though, Councillor Mitchell, now for 4 to 5 years. We're just going to go over the same thing. I think probably we would like to move, Chair, that we have a total overnight ban of any vehicles in those two areas that I've mentioned from the hours of 12 midnight to 7 a.m. the following morning, and then report back perhaps when that's been implemented.
So that's a resolution, right? Yes. Leslie, I'm sorry. Okay. Just before we vote on that, please. Mark. We are a committee. The duty of this committee is to make a recommendation to Cabinet. But after what we've heard tonight, and it is pressing, Mark, and this has been going on for a long time, is there any viability if we recommend, as Leslie's just done, that we could actually implement this sooner rather than later? Because it's no use this committee now making a recommendation, we carry it forward, and by the time we meet here again, when's our next meeting, Mike, in October, we still haven't done anything because of the ramifications, the legal side of it, the cost. So if we carry this recommendation tonight, could this be implemented? Could you give us a time scale and what the cost will be, Mark, please?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I think just from an officer point of view, we'd, if we were looking to introduce a ban, for example, as Councillor Rennie has suggested, there's obviously a, well, there's a legal process to go through, you know, as much as anything else. So, you know, even the funding issue aside, so there's the, there's working up the costings of introducing the scheme, the markings and the signs, etc. There's that legal process to go through. We have to advertise the traffic regulation order for, you know, for restrictions such as that. Obviously give the people a chance to pass their views. And very often, as many members around this table are familiar, we then have that, you know, that highways panel in place, and sometimes representations come back here to the committee. So what I would say from an officer point of view is there's been a really, my perception would be there's been a very, very good debate here tonight. There's been some very good and some new suggestions and ideas. And certainly, from my point of view, I really want to take some of these suggestions away and actually give those proper, you know, proper looking at and see, you know, see how we can progress those. And obviously, you know, reporting back to the committee. I think the next meeting is in September. I think a comprehensive piece of work to work through those options, understand the detailed feasibility, bear in mind the summer break. You know, we're going to be coming back round the table for this committee very soon anyway. But I've certainly got the message from all members around the table that this is something where they're looking for action from officers, and we want to see something coming back very quickly.
Okay, thank you for that, Mark. So we can't stress enough, this committee tonight cannot stress enough the urgency of this, Mark. And it has been kicking around for a long time for various reasons. We don't want to go over all that again. So please, can we come back with a resolution from yourselves about how we can resolve this with all the issues? And there's been really some good points made tonight. So as quickly as possible, please, Mark. Now, I did see you indicating, Julie, is this with a resolution?
Well, it was going to be a friendly amendment. I think Councillor Hackett might have some.
So we've got an amendment to that, Pat? Or another resolution? Is it an amendment?
Yeah. Can it be an abstract? Please. I'd like to propose that we set up a working party and invite all the stakeholders, as Councillor Leach mentioned earlier on, to make representations to enable recommendations to be brought back to this committee so that it can make an informed decision.
Right. Just for Dave, do you want to bring something else?
Just a friendly amendment to that, read the title, and it would be the management of camper vans at coastal and other locations in the world.
Thank you. Excuse me. So let's get this clear, Mark. We've got two resolutions here. One is immediately, if not sooner, about putting a ban on for overnight sleeping in all the areas, not just New Brighton, as Dave's just alluded to, in all areas, in all coastal areas. And then we've got another resolution which we're going to vote on, where we have a workshop, and I do think that's important, because it's very, very complex. It's a very complex issue, as we've discussed here tonight. So we've got two resolutions. One, as quickly as possible, please, and then we'll, as a committee, we'll sort out a working party on this. Is that agreeable to all sides?
Can we just, so that we are clear, that we say that we are looking for a ban as a priority?
Yes. We're going to vote on that now, yeah. Yes, but I hope I've made that.
Yeah. Yeah. And expense on workshop also.
And, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that understood? Jean, have you got anything else to add?
I just want to be clear on this. Can Mark actually tell us whether it's legal to do that? We make a decision tonight to implement
sleeping. As a council, we don't know at the moment is the answer to that. That's what the officers are going to do. They're going to come as quickly as they're going to come back, not before the next meeting, which is in September. We're going to find out as soon as we possibly can the implications
of what's been suggested. The implications of introducing an overnight ban on sleeping.
But we can't vote on having it.
Well, we can vote for the resolution. We can certainly vote for the resolution.
Can I suggest, David, could you add to the end of the resolution, subject to the council having the powers to do so?
Yes.
Agreed on that. Yeah. Okay. Okay, team. So can we vote on Leslie's, the first resolution, an overnight ban on sleeping along our coastline, to be implemented as soon as we possibly can. All those in favour? I haven't given the wording word for word. I think we're all aware now of what
we're
okay.
My understanding is that you're asking officers to go away and subject to the council having the powers to do so, you would like to see a ban on overnight sleeping the two stubble, I call them stubble dead end roads where these vehicles are currently parked.
Yes,
and clearly we will research it and then we will consider whether we can use it or not, depending on the research we do.
Overnight sleeping. All those in favour, please raise your hand. All those against? Any abstentions? That's carried. All those in favour of a workshop to be set up as soon as possible with all the stakeholders involved. All those in favour? Anyone against? Any abstentions? That's carried. Thank you very much. That was a very exhaustive Mark, thanks very much. Thank you. Mark, don't go too far. Members, Chris, Leslie, item 5, recommissioning of highway services from October 2018.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Chair. So we've got a little bit more of a meeting this evening. As members are aware, and as per the report that you have in your papers, we're going through the very important process and project at the moment of recommissioning our highway services.
Yeah.
You'll be aware, by way of background, that we made the decision just before Christmas that when the current contract with Van Lutsall for all of those services comes to an end at the end of September of this year, that we are going to bring those services currently carried out by Van back under the direct control of the council. And this presentation that I'll be looking to run through now is really to bring that report that you have to life. And to just go into a little bit more detail around actually what we're doing around that. So as we've said, you've got that background there. So approval was given to do this last year. We'll be looking to move to this new approach from the 1st of October. It's what we call a part commission, part direct delivery model. So, by way of background, there's actually round about £6 million worth of value in the current contract. That's broken down into roughly a two-thirds, one-third split between we spend about £4 million a year on what we call planned structural type schemes. So all of those big major highway maintenance projects that you see where we're doing those plain out reconstruction schemes, all of that work which interestingly has always been put out to external contractors and was subcontracted out by that model, this new arrangement will include that. And then very importantly, we actually have around about £2 million worth a year of what we call routine reactive type services. So these are the areas that are very close to members' hearts. are operatives out there on the ground, filling the potholes, repairing the streetlights, and very much are very often responsible for the operational response to what comes through your post bag and what you record on CouncilNet. And the idea would be that we'll look to set up an operational unit within delivery services under David Armstrong's area. Those people will be employed in that area to do that kind of work. Very importantly, the team that we have at the moment in high load management, so Brian Smith and the team of street works managers, street scene managers and inspectors, that particular team will be working in the same way in terms of, you know, the inspections of the highway, making sure that liability claims are dealt with and working schedule, etc. So it's really important to just touch on what the project is about and what we're trying to achieve. We've given briefings to our own and to BAM staff this week about what this project is all about. This is an outcomes framework of essentially setting out the rural plan and the rural plan pledge at the top, the key parts of the pledge outcomes, and then really importantly, in the business case for the project, you'll see there that we're about maintaining a safe and serviceable highway network. We want to deliver value for money through cost-effective asset management. We want to deliver a customer-focused quality service and respect the environment all at the same time. And I will make sure that all members get a copy of these slides after this presentation. And then below that, we then translate that into a series of performance measures for the new arrangements. And importantly, we'll be bringing that operation back into the council within delivery services, where even within the council, we're making sure that there's a service level agreement in place between the highway inspection and that client function and the operational teams that are carrying out the work on the ground. So there are two aspects to this. So we have a commercial management service. So this is the team led by Nicky Butterworth and Simon Fox. They are taking a broader role within the council and actually playing a really important role in helping the council to be more commercial across all of its areas of business. But one of the really important things that they're doing around this project is over the coming weeks, they need to get a series of commissioned contract arrangements in place. So on the planned structural side of the business, where we've got about £4 million worth of capital to spend, we're actually looking at getting about 7 different contract arrangements in place. The big issue for us there in terms of timeliness is that, as many of you will be aware, for things like the major road improvements, so where we are doing those plain out resurfacing schemes and the HRA type schemes, as members you'll be very aware that that kind of work, we approve our capital programme and we tend to issue that in the spring anyway. So quite a lot of the value in this area. We have got a little bit more time. We don't need to meet that October date, but we need to make sure that those contracts are in place, certainly in the new year. Having said that, there is an important area for us. The integrated transport area that many of you will be familiar with, this includes things like pedestrian crossings, cycleway schemes, the improvements that are identified through the active travel form, etc., etc. We have got a significant amount of money that we need to spend before the end of the financial year, about £1 million worth of work there, and we are working hard to make sure, Simon and the team, that we've got those necessary contract arrangements in place from that October deadline to get that work carried out before the end of the financial year. Moving on to the delivery services side, so this is really the new element that we're looking to, that operational capability that we're looking at setting up within the council. So as we've said there, delivery services will mobilise operations, will carry out a planned routine and reactive maintenance on Wills Highway Network with the support of external contractors necessary, and we'll get those service level agreements in place. This table that we've got here is a really good example of some of the kind of works, and this whole question around making sure we've got business continuity on the 1st of October and we have the necessary arrangements in place. So as you can see there, quite a straightforward schematic. So obviously things like the emergency call-outs and some of those emergency repairs, things like street furniture, street lights, where we've got a traffic accident and we need an emergency response to that. From the 1st of October at 01:00 in the morning, we obviously within the council need that arrangement in place in the morning for them. But then what we will be doing, certainly during that first that first week of October, all of those broader routine reactive functions, whether it be regular cleaning of drains, the general small-scale road and pavement repairs, carrying out road markings, doing repairs to street furniture and signs and little bins and things like that, we're looking to make sure we've got arrangements in place so that within that first week all those areas of business are up and running for where we need them to be. In terms of the broad strategy for delivering the work within that new highway operations business unit, what we do in practice is a significant amount of the work we do with our own people, but as BAM do it now, even in delivery services, it will be necessary for us to have what we call subcontract arrangements in place to make sure that we carry out the work. So really, just a quick diagrammatic of that split between the things that initially we'll be doing with our own people and where we might use subcontractors as needed. This is the direct delivery element. So certainly from that day one, on the reactive side, so we've got the call-outs and those either those one-day responses or one-week responses, things like dangerous potholes and pavements and those emergency responses to streetlights, it will be our own people in our own vehicles and equipment, etc., that are carrying out that work for the council as at day one. And then also, all the work that we'll be doing with our own people directly will be, we have other less urgent work to do that's of a planned routine nature that will come through from the client side. That tends to be packages of work for pothole repairs that will be on a 24-day response, or it might be traffic sign replacements that are on a 40-day response. All of that kind of work, things like drainage and gully repairs, that kind of work as well will be done by our own, what will be council operatives within delivery service. And then in terms of where we think we'll need to start with, have a subcontract arrangement in place, we're just in the process at the moment of going out through the construction line database and portal to invite firms to bid to be our subcontractor partner for helping us to deliver some of the work in this area. It covers road and pavement repairs and planned routine work as well of a more significant nature. So the idea would be really to supplement the resource that we've got and to make sure that we can deliver all of the work that comes in, and particularly those peaks and troughs in workload. We'll be looking at going through construction line to make sure that we have a contractor on board working with us, probably an 18-month tender to give us that flexibility we need to make sure that we deliver all the work and the quality expected of us. One of the questions that we get certainly from the employees who are with BAM at the moment, who will come into the council, will be an idea of what that employee structure looks like. At the moment, we have about 25 people, 25 names who are on that TUPE list, who are captured by this process. There's a couple of more senior posts within the current BAM structure who